Good afternoon. Welcome to our worship today as we gather not only for communion, but as we begin the first Sunday of Advent in this Advent season. And those are words I didn't think I'd say anytime soon, because it feels like it was only March, about 2 or 3 days ago. So this is very odd for me, but here we are. We're on our way to Christmas. We are on the literal countdown now, 4 Sundays from now and then a little bit more. But also, tomorrow, and something that I have to use my phone for because it's where my book called For All the Saints is, Monday, is also St. Andrew's Day. And since this being a St. Andrew's church, I want to share a little something with you. So everybody grab a seat just for a second. I'm going to read this for you today. Tomorrow, we will be honoring St. Andrew the Apostle. We honor the memory of an apostle named Andrew. The Gospels say he was a fisherman and the brother of Peter, and his name always appears at the top of the list of the 12 apostles. The 4th Gospel pairs him with Philip, one of my favorite saints. That's not what it says here, but it's true. In answering the Lord's questions at the feeding of the 5,000, and later acting as an intermediary between pagans who wished to meet Jesus. But that is all. Andrew's story is no longer sooner begun than it is swallowed up by the greater story of Jesus. The people of the church later invented legends about Andrew to give their memory more than just some name to honor and a single episode to recount. The legends involve Andrew having adventures traveling and preaching in many different places, and then he was martyred, crucified on a cross in the form of an X. So if you'll notice when you leave today, there's a large blue and white cross shield that is the symbol of St. Andrew, and also in the cross of Scotland, by the way. But yeah, that's his symbol because he was remembered as a martyr crucified in an X. Some of these legends are true, some cannot be proven, but others provide a purpose or a function. We come back to the Gospels and their account of Andrew's calling, most importantly though. He was a fisherman minding his own business, mending his nets, and then along came Jesus. The Lord called to him, and Andrew got up, and he went with him. He walked into Jesus' story, and from that moment on, his life was never the same. Andrew had no other story but the story of Jesus to tell. The story that was told about Jesus is a part of his own. And that is how we honor his memory, by remembering that as we tell the story of Jesus, he calls many. And one of the first was Andrew, who was called to salvation. So that's how we remember him today. So with all that in mind, as well as the many things we're remembering today, we will be celebrating, I should say, tomorrow, St. Andrew's Day, as this is the namesake of our church here in Glenwood. So with that in mind as well, before we get too wrapped up in everything, we're going to also start Advent. So we're going to come up and light the candle, and I got a few helpers with me today. So if they'd be so, yes please, masks on for anybody who's helping. That's very important.
There we go. Would you guys go up on the steps so I can, okay. We can see what we're doing.
So, this candle here. Actually, you know what? That candle there could be either you have.
In a world where many hope, we call upon you, O Lord of hope, to come. Go.
In this season of Advent, we wait for the coming of hope into our world. We await the birth of the first child, the coming of God into our lives in a new way.
Come, Messiah, come and save us.
She's having a lot of trouble. Let's tip them over.
There we go.
There you go.
Ah, you got it, okay. Now, you can't blow it out with your mask on. We found that out earlier today. So here, watch, I'll show you a secret. When you want to turn out that candle, watch. Gone, and then comes back out again. That easy? All right, well, thank you. We got one more thing to say. We're going to say it together. Dear God, we pray for the hope that is in Christ to come into our lives in a new way. May we become hope that is alive in our world.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Now, the little hymn that's there as part of the lighting of the candle is to the tune of Away in the Manger. We're going to sing that together. First hymn now, which is in your song book. Ooh. Number 213, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Say that whole thing together, the song of Zechariah. Actually, we'll say it responsibly by the spacing. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. He has come to his people to set them free.
He has raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of his servant David.
Through his holy prophets, he promised of old that he would save us from our enemies and from the hands of all who hate us.
He promised to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant.
This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, that he would set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life.
You, my child, shall be called the Rock of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins.
In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us to shine on those who dwell in the darkness and shadow of death and guide our feet into the way of peace. And we say, Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our collect for today is right there in your bulletin. And I know you got two bulletins, but this is the one with the order of service in it. So we're going to say that collect prayer together as well. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light, now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to us in great humility, that on the last day when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal through him who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the proclamation of the word, and Karen is going to come up and read our first reading for us today.
A reading from the book of Isaiah 64, chapter 1 to 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations will tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that you did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who work for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember in your ways. But you are angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like filthy cloth. We will fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and delivered us into the hands of your iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not exceed angrily, O Lord, and do remember the iniquity forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I'm going to keep my mask on so that we don't share a mic. Our psalm for this afternoon is number 80, and it's found on page 812 in your book of alternative service. We're going to read it responsibly by the verse. Verses, 1 to 7 and 16 to 18. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock, shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim. In the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh, stir up his strength and come to help us. Restore us, O God of hosts, show the light of your countenance, and we will be saved.
O Lord of hosts, come to leave in anger, despite the prayers of your people.
You have fed them with the bread of tears, you have given them bowls of tears to drink.
You have made us the division of our neighbors, and our enemies by us to so long.
Restore us, O God of hosts, show us the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. And so will we never turn away from you. Give us life that we may call upon your name.
Restore us, O Lord God of hosts, show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
The prayer at the end is on page 814, and we say, Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ, our good shepherd. You have led us to the kingdom of your Father's love. Forgive our careless indifference to your loving care for all your creatures, and remake us in the likeness of your new and risen life. We ask this in your name.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 3 to 9. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge and of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you are called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
You go ahead. No, I'm sorry.
Are we ready?
Yep. Number 170 in your songbook. Sorry.
Sing them over. Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said, in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth and to the ends of heaven. And from the fig tree we learn this lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender, it puts forth leaves. You should know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. But what about that day or hour? No one knows. Neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home, he puts his servants in charge, each one to his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come. In the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all. Keep awake. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. So, like I said at the beginning of the service, I still can't believe we're already talking about Advent. I still can't believe we're getting ready for Christmas. And don't even get me started about the things I got to do around the house. And I'm not in charge of anything interior, I'm all exterior. So that's a whole other thing. But in the midst of all of this, I've also been in touch with a lot of my peers, because they can't believe it either. Other clergy up along are just kind of like, they can't understand that it is this time of year, because in a lot of parts of Canada, we can't have the luxury to do what we're doing right now. We forget sometimes how this, believe it or not, you gapped out in little groups in different separate pews and all the ways that you're sat together. Except one family. You got the whole thing to yourself. You're doing all right. But seriously, this is a luxury. This is a blessing to be able to do this at all. Because I got a lot of friends up along who are doing it either single service, like just by themselves, or two or three of them gathering to put on the internet, or doing it from their house. And it's getting a bit wearing thin. They're hurting. They really are. Not just because they miss people like yourselves coming together. Not just that. But this isn't really how we work. Clergy aren't very good, despite what people may think, at being by ourselves. We are very, very, very social people. Even the shy ones. Don't let them fool you. Even the shy ones don't mind a few people. And that's nice. But a lot of us are hurting about this, and I've been speaking to a lot of them about it, even some of my peers out in the Eastern Diocese, who keep in your prayers, because they've just voted a new bishop into the way, similar to, you know, a bishop-elect, kind of like the somebody else-elect downtown. We're not going to talk about that. But no, in a very similar way, they have a bishop-elect, Sam Rose, so keep him in your prayers as he comes into this position. He actually just put a message out today. But I was talking to a few of my peers, and we got on the topic of a bunch of things. I mentioned I was going to be talking about St. Andrew today, and we started talking about favorite saints. For me, that's easy. And for all of you, before you start laughing, listen, when it comes to clergy, saints for us are like hockey cards. I mean, that we have ones that we know, and we think about their stats, like, okay, who redeemed the most people? And who got enough breakaways? And stuff like that. Oh no, it's all in there. But one of my favorites, too, actually, St. Philip's is my home, and I've always been interested in Philip, but it's not very extravagant, because he's known as the fellow what got the bread. Seriously, go look it up. His shield is basically a big old shield with a cross in the middle, and two pieces of bread. That's it, because he was the one who found the kid with the fish and the loaves. That's it. That's the big thing that Philip's remembered for, and other things too. But he hung out with Andrew, so that was kind of cool. And I love Nicholas, but of course I do. I mean, who wouldn't be excited about Nicholas this time of year, right? My friend, though, my fellow clergy, she loves Francis of Assisi. Now, for those of you who don't know who St. Francis is, that's the one making a channel of your peace, where that poem comes from. He was a monk, he was a really down-to-earth kind of guy, and he was so saintly, he was told, that he was kind of like the Snow White of the saints. He'd be out in the woods just walking through the forest, and all of a sudden, like, fawns and chipmunks and birds would land on him. That's how saintly he was. That's kind of what he was known for. He was a very woodsy kind of a guy. But a very ordinary fellow with an extraordinary faith, because he was known for being fully immersed in this faithful life. One of my favorite stories that she told me about Francis was about him out in his front garden digging potatoes. So keep up with me now. This is an exciting story. But he's out in his front yard digging potatoes, and there's a merchant from the nearby town saw him doing as such, and he walked past and he thought, what a ridiculous thing for a man of God to be doing. Because what a man of God should be doing is going and telling everybody about the end times. What a man of God should be doing is going out and warning people that they're being sinful. What a man of God should be doing is not being on his hands and knees in the dirt. So he approached Francis to make fun of him. And he said, Friar, if you knew tomorrow was the end of days, if you knew tomorrow it was it, Jesus was coming, what would you find yourself doing today? If you knew it was all over tomorrow, what would you find yourself doing today? So Francis got up, dusted off his hands, and kind of looked at him for a second, thought about it, and said, I'd probably be digging potatoes. And he got back down and right back at it. And he stopped only for a moment to do that, too. Because that's something it illustrates as not only as what St. Francis was like, but talks a lot about what the gospel is talking about today, too. Because when we begin this season that we're doing right now, we are beginning a season of waiting. Preparation and waiting. And that's hard to do, too, because we've had a lot of waiting. We've already done a bunch of waiting. But this season is coming to the light of the world is supposed to be coming. We celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ to lighten this very darkness that we've been waiting to break through for a while. For the gospel reading today, a very grown-up Jesus, not a baby Jesus at all, is talking about that very darkness that we're trying to get through. It's talking about the end days. Jesus is talking, just like many of the readings we've had these past couple of weeks, he's stressing the importance of understanding that the end is coming. The day, as he says, after all the suffering, when the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the sun and the stars will be falling from heaven, and all the powers of heaven will be shaken. And the Son of Man will be seen coming in the clouds with great power and glory. That's pretty neat. But the end, in reality, is part of our existence in God's creation. That's just the way things are. If something has a beginning, there's going to be an end. So first thing he's talking about there is that this will happen. But the other thing he stresses is important, too, is not just to be mindful of what's coming, but not to be doing so at the expense of the present. You got to recognize that, yeah, things are going to come, but there are great things of powerful importance on the way, absolutely. But just because that's coming later doesn't mean that we got to overlook what's happening right now. These things will come in due season. We have to keep in mind what we're doing here and now, just as mindful as things that are not yet come. And he uses a fig tree to explain it. If you don't have a fig tree, apple tree will do. But whatever you got in your yard, as seasons change from spring to summer to fall to winter, y'all know what happens. The buds come, the fruit grows, falls off, leaves fall, and now here we are. And these things happens regardless of ye. It happens regardless of any of us. The tree will grow and the tree will fall regardless of you, unless you cut it down. I'm not telling you to go cut down a tree, but I am saying that these things in season happen. And the thing about it is we just have to wait sometimes to watch it happen. But even while we're watching these seasons take effect, Jesus even says, no one knows about the day or the hour, not the angels, not the Son himself, but only the Father, as to how all these things he's talking about are going to come to play. Just as we acknowledge and recognize that the seasons pass, as they do, we recognize that the days which Jesus speaks of, we'll recognize them when they come. But for now, we have to remain part of the living, moving world around us. The here and now. We have to watch and wait. Be on guard, Jesus says. Like that soldier we just sang about. With the soldier that keeps watch for the enemy while not losing sight of the camp behind him. I mean, how much good of a soldier are you going to be if you're only pointed in one direction and then Buddy sneaks up on the flank? That's not going to be any good. You have to be aware of everything. And you have to be wary of the people behind you right now. We can't dismiss the reality of this life just to watch for the end. And this is exactly what St. Francis was getting on with when he was talking about those potatoes. We have to live our lives as part of the ordinary world that surrounds us, despite the fact that right now it's far from ordinary. Part of the daily ins and outs and tasks that come to us, but not without knowing what is to come and what to watch for. To be part of the ordinary is not to be ignorant of what is to come. On the contrary, it's an opportunity for us to be active in our faith with those around us as we live our lives. If we are constantly mindful and prepared of the day for the Son of Man's return, and then we carry on with this part of our life in this world around us, with that knowledge in our minds, in our hearts, and everything that we do, then you are keeping watch, aren't you? I mean, if you don't, you already know what's going to happen, so just don't forget, and that'll be fine. If we live our lives according to what Christ taught us, if we live normally, but in keeping with the basic tenets that he left us, to recognize God in every day that we are gifted, even in moments like this, especially in moments like this, but the fact that we are blessed enough to be able to gather, that's a little thing. The fact we can get out of our houses, the fact that the only thing you've got to do is wear one of these things to go around for now, that's pretty great. We forget those blessings. So we give thanks to God for those little things, and we also recognize God in each other. These are the little things he's asked us to do. And if we bring that message of forgiveness and salvation found in the coming of Jesus Christ to earth as a human being, in the greatest gift to all people, in that light of Christ that we celebrate this time of year, then we're all set. There's not much left to do. Think of it this way. Here's a good way to think of it. Who got a root cellar? Anybody? Who got a root cellar? All right. Who got a bomb shelter? Eh? All right. Let's skip to the big one, huh? Nobody? Anybody got a hole in the ground with the doors just in case anything goes wrong? Newfoundlanders are like that. We're fairly confident. But nevertheless, think of it as a bomb shelter, though. If you had a place of refuge that any disaster strikes, you're ready. Like an intense storm, an earthquake, or heaven forbid, the bomb started to fall. If you had such a shelter, you'd have it stocked to the brim with everything necessary, wouldn't you? It's a place to be prepared for. You would continue living, but at the same time, you'd have it ready. But if you had such a place, would you go live there now? No tornado. No. I don't hear anything. So, seems like a very irresponsible thing to go in a bomb shelter now, wouldn't it? You wouldn't go there now. You wouldn't drop everything today on this miserable afternoon just to work, right in the middle of your day, just to run down the shelter, lock the doors, and stay there just in case. No. But this shelter was built to keep you alive when needed, isn't it? It exists in the background of your constant and ordinary life. And in Jesus' case, he's talking today about stocking up a spiritual bomb shelter. To have everything prepared back there, but as part of what you're already doing. Because you can't stop those shelves if you stop doing what you're doing now. If you ignore what's coming too, or become too involved in the world around you, those shelves are never going to get filled up, and you'll never be prepared. When Jesus once again uses the image of a man leaving the house on a journey, putting his servants in charge while he's gone, the master leaves each servant with an assigned task. And all the while, the servants are all preparing and watching for his return. He got stuff to do, and at the same time, they're keeping an eye out. And this is the same for us every day. We have things we have to do every day. Rudimentary, day-to-day stuff. And if we lived and worked as our master has asked of us while he's been away, if we are faithful servants to what he's asked, then we're all set. We are ready for his return, the extraordinary, no matter what hour or day it happens. As we move through Advent, as you get ready for Christmas, I have two requests. One, put up as many lights as you can find, because we need to brighten this place up. And I don't mean that there's anything wrong with your houses. I just mean, let's bring out a light of Christ into the world that can also be just as bright in the electrical kind. But at the same time, make sure that spiritual bomb shelter you got is stocked high with everything necessary for a life in the gift found in Christ. And don't get lost staring at the trees, waiting for change to come. For when Christ comes, he won't find us sleeping, just as he said. The last thing he said in our gospel today is something I want you to keep at heart. Keep awake. Keep watch. He'll be ready. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful that we can gather as we do. We are grateful in all the blessings that we share.
But as we prepare for this time where we celebrate once again the birth of your Son into this world, remind us as well of the light that we not only get from him, but that we share in each other. Remind us that no matter how prepared we may be, we are always ready to help those to be even more prepared by sharing that gift with them. Continue to work in us, that we may be ready for anything that comes as your good and faithful servants. In your name we pray. Amen.
Talked about the coming of the Lord. This song is doing basically the same thing. It's called He's Coming Soon. That's a really upbeat song, so here we go.
The Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our prayers today are found in your bulletin as well. And in keeping in your prayers today, as I already said, we're going to remember in our prayers the Anglican Diocese in the eastern part of Newfoundland, Labrador. And as I said, we pray that we continue to pray for all those who are involved and part of that diocese, and as well as for the Bishop-elect Sam Rose, as he prepares for his time to lead and to guide that diocese. We also pray for, in our Anglican cycle of prayer, for the Lusitanian Church, their bishop, the Right Reverend George Pina Cabral. In our provincial prayer care, we remember the Diocese of Montreal and their bishop, Mary Irwin Gibson. And in our tri-diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for the parish of Trinity Port Rexton and their record of Reverend John Sparks and all of the congregations under his care. And the parish of Twillingate, our neighbor, and the Reverend Dr. Joanne Mercer and all the churches under her care as well. And as always, we pray for our companion diocese of Rokan, South Sudan, Bishop Francis, and all of his people. At the beginning of this Advent season, let us offer our prayers to God as we say, Lord, have mercy. That our gracious Savior may rouse us from sleep and make us attentive to the nearness of his presence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may discover God's word in every sound of this world, God's touch in every human embrace, and God's love in every gesture of self-sacrifice among us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That divine energy and holy grace may bring our hearts to vigilance and make us see with uncovered eyes the Christ who suffers in his people's agonies. We pray today for those who are sick, those in hospital or receiving treatments, those who are struggling or alone, those who we list as part of this video on our Facebook page who we remember today, and those who have asked for our prayers. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may come to recognize in our holy assembly gathered for prayer that Jesus the Christ is here with us to make our songs of praise and pleading his own. Let us pray to the Lord. That God's coming in the days and years of our human history may always be new, always brimming with light to drive the darkness away. Let us pray to the Lord. We say together, make ready our hearts for your coming, O Lord, and receive our prayers in the name of the one who comes, our gracious Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Continuing on page 191. Dear friends, in Christ, God is steadfast in love, his infinite mercy. He welcomes sinners, he invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins together as we are confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. For Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters in Christ, may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Now, I know in our prayers we just said something about keeping precious embraces between each other, but we're not allowed. So unless you're in a bubble, don't give any hugs or kisses, but share that peace with each other, because that is how we do things. Peace of Christ be with you all. Now, our offertory hymn?
Number 16.
Number 16, that's right. In your songbook, number 16 is our next hymn. Our offering is received in the back of church, but at the same time, we prepare the altar for the rest of our offering and that which we bring. So number 16 in your songbook, we're going to sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh,
say the prayer over the gifts found in our bulletin together. God of love and power, your word stirs within us the expectation of the coming of your Son. Accept all we offer you this day and sustain us with the promise of eternal life. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Time came among us in our flesh and opened to us the way of salvation. Now we watch for the day when he will come again in power and great triumph to judge this world, that we, without shame or fear, may rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you've made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your words spoken from the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, and out of death into life. On the night that he was handed over to suffering and death, the death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, and we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new. And bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. On page 212, the breaking of bread for Advent, which is number 5, there at the bottom of 212. God of promise, you prepare a banquet for us in your kingdom.
And prepare those who are called to suffer with him.
These are the gifts of God for you, people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Every time I turn around, God is blessing me. Every time I turn around, God is blessing me. Every time I turn around, God is blessing me. Sing thank you, Jesus. Sing hallelujah.
You're going to give in loving memory of. And they're all here, familiar ones, anything from Away in the Manger, to the First Noel, to Silent Night, all familiar ones. I'll be helping, but I'm also going to be inviting anybody who'd like to do a solo of one. So that's something as well that we'll be doing. So that's something we're going to be doing, and all the details about that is there. Everything else you can read for yourself. I just want to draw those to your attention. Yep. And the other thing besides that is all the celebrations we may or may not be having. Unless I missed an announcement. Anything else? If not, who is having a birthday? Anniversary. Celebration of any kind. What's on the call box?
My mommy.
I hear somebody, but I don't see you. Who's mommy? Your mommy?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Yeah, don't tell us how old she is. Unless you want to.
I don't know.
Okay.
She's going to tell you everything, eh?
Well, remind me mommy's first name.
Carrie-Anne.
There we go, Carrie-Anne. Well, very happy birthday to her tomorrow, however old she is. So very happy birthday to her. And nice to have for you guys to remind me. Thank you very much. By the way, you guys have been stellar. I do have one more thing I got to say. I have something for whoever wants to do it. My wife, Stephanie, and I put together a little kit. This is make your own advent wreath at home. You paint the plate, and then you take all the bits and you glue them on. The instructions are inside. I'm not doing it justice. So just hold it up. But everything you need is in this bag. You can take it home and make your own advent wreath. And thank goodness you're here, because I have three left. And that's enough for all of you. So perfect. However, if someone knows another person who'd like one, we are thinking about making more. So just let me know and I'll make sure to bring more for any other little ones that might not be here today. But you guys, definitely. You're taking one of these home before you go, eh?
Yeah.
All right. And then, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be doing little videos every week to tell you guys what each candle is for. So that'll be fun too. So there you go. Thank you for being so good today. You've been very helpful. Anybody else got a birthday coming? Yes, ma'am.
My sister's birthday is today.
Oh, it's today. Who's your sister?
Eva Bungie from Harbor Breton.
Eva Bungie from Harbor Breton. God bless her. Happy birthday to you. Anybody else?
My cousin Betty from St. Philip's, your hometown.
Oh my, all the way from St. Philip's. Well, very happy birthday to her.
My third.
When is it?
The third.
Oh, the third. Okay, it's the week. That's right. Anybody else? Oh.
My nephew's.
Jake Taylor is tomorrow.
He's from Conception Bay, but he didn't know
that. Oh, God bless him. Well, I hope he's staying safe. So stay safe up there, buddy. But happy birthday all the same. Anybody else? All right. Well, if you're going to sing with me, put your mask on. Happy birthday to you. Celebratory things? Like we had somebody who's, anybody? Anybody get like an A on a test or a gold medal in something or B plus? I'll sell for B plus guys. B minus? Down the back, what is it?
Well, my grandson's got the high honor of the smartest sniper in the forces.
Oh!
Wow. Very, very high honor.
So what's his name?
Matthew.
Matthew?
Matthew Johnson.
Say again?
Matthew Johnson.
Matthew Johnson got the high honor of the
top
sniper in the forces. Yeah. Woof. Well, all right, I'll take it. That's a wonderful thing. Wow. That's national, isn't it? That's national. Well, very good. I don't know if singing the anniversary song will suit that. But congratulations all the same. That's good, too. All right, well, with all that in mind, folks, God bless you. I think we've kept you long enough. We've got to get home for supper. And I gotta upload this video. So we got one more hymn to sing, and I'm gonna help sing it. Number 50, is it, boys?
Yes.
50 in the song book. And I've already forgotten what number that is. 50 is. Oh, God will take care of you. So number 50 in your song book, we'll sing that, and we'll make our way out. God bless you, and thank you. Stand up while I'm coming, come on.
We got to get you guys in here too. That's better. There you go. And I'll just stand up in the back. Oh, thank you.
Let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.